groups rightly point out that revisionist history has led to a resurgence of socialism among America's youth. I guess at this point that nothing but experiencing the real thing, economic collapse, wide-scale persecution, and the stripping away of rights and liberties will wake these kids up to the real socialism. It's coming, kids. Be careful what you wish for, because you're just about to get it. I'm Dr. Duke, she's Katie, and this is the Dr. Duke Show. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Dr. Duke Show, the only program that keeps you educated on the craziness impacting K-12 classrooms and college campuses around the world. Today, we start with a look at revisionist history in the classroom and an active push by progressives to teach young children that America is evil and the only answer is socialism. And we start with a story from U.S. parents involved in education, USPIE. Full disclosure, I am an advisor to this organization. Alex Newman, our international correspondent, is also an active advisor to USPIE. So we start there today. And USPIE, that is U.S. parents involved in education, said in comments to Breitbart News that, quote, the battle over who will be president continues because one party is working hard to rewrite history to convince Americans that our country is bad, does not deserve the peace and prosperity we enjoy. This is the 1619 Project. It's coming. It's a current and significant example. And that's right. She's exactly right. The reason this country is in the place that it is right now is because for three generations, almost three generations now, children and their parents now, and even to some degree beginning young grandparents, have all been educated under the idea that America is racist, irredeemably sexist, bigoted, homophobic. And what's even worse than that, multiculturalism dictates, which has dominated the schools, that while you're allowed to call America racist, sexist, bigoted, you can't say that about other, actually, contemporarily racist, sexist and biggest country. So we're allowed to talk about how bad we are, but we have no right to call out the Chinese. Hey, NBA, you see what we're talking about here? You can call out us, but you can't call out real police states, places like, oh, socialist places, like North Korea. This is the world we find ourselves in, where we alone bear the burden for all the world's evils.
And as a refresher to moms and dads out there, in case for some reason you don't actually know what we're talking about with the 1619 Project, again, the New York Times editorial board really is the one who got this all started. So the New York Times decided, hey, let's actively put together our own little history curriculum, and then we're going to sell it. And by sell, it means basically just give it to all the public schools because they'll just take it because we're the New York Times. And so they came up with this Project 1619, which it refers to them saying when how the country started back in 1619 and obviously founded on slavery and racism, because that's when the first slaves got to Virginia. And so now ever since that came out, our public schools have been give us the curriculum. That's what they want to teach from, because they want to teach your kids that all this country is racist, sexist, founded on slavery, just awful, absolutely awful.
Well, let's be clear about this. It didn't take the 1619 curriculum. The 1619 curriculum is the afterthought of what they're already doing.
True.
They just didn't have a radical enough curriculum. They've already, Howard Zinn, right?
Ooh,
you,
Howard.
If you're listening to me now, you probably grew up in your public school with Howard Zinn. Probably your children grew up, if you're an older person, your children certainly grew up with Howard Zinn, and kids are getting still Howard Zinn now. It's the people's history of the United States. In other words, it is a socialist recasting of America. So 1619 is late to the game. What's happened is that the overt socialism of people like Howard Zinn in the 1970s looks tame compared to where your educators want to take us now. Howard Zinn was simply pointing out how evil and capitalism was, how unfair America was. He wasn't necessarily calling for full-out rebellion. He was not arguing that America alone is the one country in the history of the world that's done these things. 1619 is the new wave of this. And you're exactly right. Public school teachers can't wait to get their hands on this. They don't want to teach history in anything like a fair and balanced way. They want to program your kids to hate their country, to despise it, so that anything that comes down the pack, that turnpike that will cause the collapse of the country or the radical restructuring of it, getting rid of the Electoral College, getting rid of free speech rights, radically censoring what people are and are not to say. This is what's coming down the road, and your kids don't even know what's been thrown away. They will never know what's been thrown away. They will think this is the new normal.
And that's why we, at least if we're going to fight back, we do have a group that is fighting back now, and you should join them. It's USPIE, as we've talked about, and they said specifically with the 1619 Project, they claim that the racism, slavery, systematic oppression, and other evils are embedded in America's founding, as we've talked about. So USPIE says there can be no change in policy and no possible transformation that would make the nation redeemable. In short, under the view put forth by the Times and its project, the only possible conclusion is that America must die so that something can replace it. And so now USPIE is fighting back, and you should join them.
Well, and it's not just that America must die, but every trace of America's actual history has to be buried.
Yes.
Mike, we have a short clip. Go ahead and show the short clip.
So much of the education policy that is now completely infected our public school system is coming from Washington, D.C., and beyond that, from the UN Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization.
What's your goal? What do you want for your child? Because the school's goal is different than what your goal is. The institution of school forms a wedge between the child and the parent. You might ask, you know, how? Child comes home, Daddy, I don't understand this. Can you help me? The dad says, I've never seen this before. I can't help you. Can't even help a fourth grader with its fourth grade math homework. Stupid, dumb daddy.
And Stupid Dumb Daddy is part of this new documentary that USPIE put forth. It said it at the end there. It's called Truth and Lies in American Education. And we recommend, strongly encourage every parent to see that.
Consider visiting the USPIE website and making a donation to the furtherance of that project. You could see Alex Newman there. You could see some really good activists. Consider visiting USPI at their website and donating.
You really gotta love it when big government organization bureaucracies do everything hush-hush and don't tell anyone about it, especially when it involves your children. So the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, aka the CDC, did basically what they do by removing some controversial guidance involving anything to do with COVID-19, because that's where we're at. They didn't give this big announcement to let you know. Parents, by the way, were changing things regarding school reopenings. Instead, they did it quietly, and they removed what was suggested about schools being open in the fall and how they should be open. So here's what the info had said on the CDC website. Here's what it had said. Scientific studies suggest that COVID-19 transmission among children in schools may be low. International studies that have assessed how readily COVID-19 spreads in schools also reveal low rates of transmission when community transmission is low. Based on current data, the rate of infection among younger school children and from students to teachers has been low, especially if proper precautions are followed. Okay. You read that, you say, kids, go to school.
Which is exactly what the American Donald Trump said they should do, right?
And now the CDC said, shh. Erase that. And so they did. They removed that information basically a good month ago about now, and they didn't tell anyone. They were like, oh, no, we're just going to pull that one back. So supposedly, the CDC director, Robert Redfield, told Democratic Representative James Clyburn of South Carolina.
That's a heck of a combination.
Good, James. He's the chairman of the House Select Subcommittee on the coronavirus crisis. Supposedly, though, the CDC director said that the information in question was out of date. So that's why they just kind of removed it, didn't tell anyone.
So what is the CDC policy now?
Well, first I got to get to Clyburn's statement. So Clyburn's response to all this was, I'm pleased that in response to this request, CDC has now removed two guidance documents unsupported by science and has agreed to update two more that Director Redfield concedes are out of date. With infections rising dramatically across the country, it's critical that schools, teachers, and families have accurate, trustworthy public health information on the coronavirus. James Clyburn.
Yeah, this is what get. Now you've got a situation just in the news today or yesterday. The New York Times grudgingly admits that Donald Trump was right to reopen the schools.
Well, but they're going to, because it was an op-ed, they're going to then, the Times itself will defend itself, being like, well, that's someone's opinion. When they get all the backlash.
It's just amazing to me that we're still a couple months away from the January inauguration of Joe Biden as the actual president of the United States. And it's amazing how the narrative, with education in particular, the narratives are changing now. They've got the monster out in their mind. They did everything they could do to lie, cheat, steal, to cover up information that would have made Trump's policy look like a natural, effective policy. Now that's done. Now everything that's being done is to shine the brightest possible halo over Joe Biden. And think about it. What has Joe Biden said with regards to the states? He's already said, we're not going to push a federal lockdown. Well, isn't that what he was yelling at Trump for not doing?
Mm-hmm.
All those months and months. Trump's doing nothing. What did Trump do? Trump said, let the states deal with it. States have different levels of infection. States have different mechanisms for coping depending upon where they are. Colder states, hotter states. Trump's entire plan was let the states deal with it. And now what is Biden saying? Hey, let's let the states deal with it. But for 6 to 8 months, all we heard on the campaign is that Donald Trump was doing it wrong. And now we find out he was doing it so wrong, Trump, that now Biden's doing it exactly the same way.
Well, and I mean, this is what politics is. They're always just going to go opposite of whatever the other guy says.
What the Republican says. That's what they're going to undermine, correct?
Well, in this instance, it's Trump. It doesn't matter what Trump's Republican, Democrat. It's just Trump. It's just Trump. It doesn't matter who it is. But if Trump said it, you do the opposite. That's where we've been for the past 4 years of our lives. And it will continue because for years to come, everything that happens if Biden, we're going off a tangent, but in Biden's presidency, if he becomes officially president, it's going to be good that Biden did it because Trump would have done it bad. Like, they're still going to pull Trump in because they can't.
And what's going to happen is as long as people are dying, that's Trump. The minute people stop trying, that's the genius of Joe Biden.
This is very
Wasn't he brilliant, Katie, to do nothing?
He was so brilliant.
Wasn't he just brilliant to do absolutely nothing different?
It was the right thing to do.
Oh, that was amazing.
Well, the CDC website does still say, and I'm sure people have screenshot this many a time, that the many benefits of in-person schooling should be weighed against the risks posed by COVID-19 spread. Of key significance, in-person learning is in the best interest of students when compared to virtual learning. Application and adherence to mitigation measures provided in this document and similar to those implemented at essential workplaces can help schools reopen and stay open safely for in-person learning. So I'm sure they're going to quietly remove that one next.
Of course.
Because science!
Well, and this is the thing. You know, what always bothers me when you hear particularly Democrats talking about science, because science is mythology. It's politics now. And their science is the science, you have to believe.
Yes.
I've been around since before 1970, I'm sad to say. And ever since 1970, I've been hearing end of the world tomorrow. Miami and New York underwater by 1980. The ocean's dead by 1985. 50 years of false hysterical claims. Yet we're still not allowed to question that because that's anti-science, don't you know?
Of course.
Same thing with the coronavirus. What did the Chinese tell Joe Biden as some? They gave him some advice for becoming president. One is to stop blaming China and adopt the narrative.
Okay.
Seriously,
uh-huh,
the Chinese
uh-huh,
said this:
uh-huh.
Adopt the narrative that the uh-huh. virus started in Italy. So to call it the Chinese virus.
The Italians, he's picking on you, the Italians.
Yes, to call it the Chinese virus is horrible. But the Chi-Coms will tell you, call it the Dago virus. I could say that.
Mussolini.
Italian, right?
Just so everyone's aware, just to give some science data, at least, Johns Hopkins University of Medicine Coronavirus Resource Center, the most recent data that I found, we're at about 11.76 million infections of COVID with 253,000 or so deaths. Now, we compare that to, well, first, for age 0 to 18, it's about 150 deaths. According to the stats that I was able to find on the CDC website, they're most updated. Maybe they have more now. But flu deaths among that grouping is about 480 every year.
So right now there's 150 deaths.
It's rough.
From people up to the age 18.
0 to 18.
And the average in that age group for just regular flu,
in the recent years,
is more than three times as
high. Yeah, in recent years. Yeah. So, you know, again, we're finding that based on what the CDC said, currently, who knows, they may quietly update that as well. And
what
then,
we're finding out, Katie, is the phrase based on the CDC doesn't mean anything anymore.
You know, as much as we may want to say that it's China that did coronavirus, and apparently China is trying to blame Italy, obviously it's capitalism that caused coronavirus.
Well, that's what we can all agree on, right?
I think we can all agree. And if you're a school child in Washington, D.C., the capital of this once great country, the D.C. public school children, that's what they're being taught. Capitalism caused the coronavirus. And this specifically happened at Hardy Middle School, where a teacher, Kanisha Mills, who teaches 8th grade history, there she is up there on the screen. Here's her, what her little profile says. Her goal is not to just facilitate schooling. Well, duh, she's a teacher. She shouldn't facilitate. She should teach. Anyway, but she has hopes to instill students with the skill of interpreting facts from the past to critically assess current events. This, she believes, is true education.
And so look at the way facts is in quotation marks.
Go ahead. We got to find out her credentials.
All right.
She's originally from Morgantown, North Carolina. Ms. Mills matriculated through Howard University, and she has a master's of education. This is
your public school
teacher currently.
And so facts, right? She's got facts in quotation marks. So any of the any ideas about American history prior to her taking over are facts.
Facts.
Right? And her conspiracy theories like this, like COVID is the consequence of capitalism. Did you know? I didn't know that, Katie. Did you know that compound interest and personal banking is a vector for disease? Did you know that?
Absolutely.
Did you know that the use of
the
accruing of interest and mortgages and free markets? Did you know that a free market is a vector for I just didn't.
And then that makes, because that's math.
See, that's a fact.
That makes math then also just overall in general what caused corona as well. So math and capitalism, just all of it.
From our young teacher, right?
Yes. Kanisha.
Facts. For Kanisha, facts include capitalism creating the coronavirus.
Yeah.
But, you know, all of the other stuff, that's facts in quotation marks.
Yeah. So as an 8th grade history teacher, she decided she's going to put the virus on trial. Woo. So she had her students, again, put them on trial. Like she made the virus, whatever. She didn't say anything about China or anything else that really caused this virus, but she had her students use defendants, because they're on trial, like it was an actual trial case, defendants of racism, capitalism, and the United States government.
Right.
And the exercise itself was called the People's Tribunal on the Coronavirus Pandemic.
Doesn't that just sound just wonderfully
eighth graders
socialist?
Trying to...
It's exactly what you'd expect from the Soviet
Politburo. I
want to
know, what was this supposed to be? They're learning about the courts? Because I highly doubt it, obviously. But
the
like, why would
you... courts are racist. We know that, don't we?
True.
This is the people's...
The people. Yeah, the fact that it's the People's Tribunal.
It's the People's Tribunal.
It's like the People's Republic of China.
In other words, kangaroo court, right?
Yeah, exactly. Okay, she said, Ms. Mills, that I wanted to point out that the capitalist system was behind the pain, trauma, isolation, and destitution my students were facing. Capitalism, racism, and the U.S. government left us to die. So even though they were supposed to be on trial, because, you know, we're supposed to have fair trials and... Not here in her little republic of Ms. Mills' class. She already had assessed and determined and found guilty.
Look at how
capitalism.
Confused her reasoning is.
True.
On the one hand, she says this is being done because capitalism left us to die.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not an argument for where it came from. So she's equating, she's wrong.
Well,
but her argument is that capitalism didn't do anything to fix it. So therefore, capitalism is responsible not just for us dying, but for the disease somehow.
Yeah, so here's how she presented this. As part of the tribunal, the students had to answer a series of questions about America's coronavirus response. Here are some of the questions. How does capitalism in the United States cause crises like the coronavirus and the flu pandemic of 1918? Whoa, let's just bring the flu pandemic in here too.
You've got 100 years of flu between those two events that our genius doesn't have any comment about.
And then automatically, she already found them guilty by asking if the government and capitalist system are guilty, what should be the sentence? Meaning you're already finding them guilty, so what should be the sentence?
Let me guess. I'll bet you the little black teacher now is suddenly all for the capital punishment. Our little progressive is now all for capital punishment when it comes to sentencing the United States and capitalism.
Yeah, well, I don't have the exact arguments, but yeah, basically. But what did she say about China? You may wonder. Did she even mention it? The material applauded China for its handling of the coronavirus without even mentioning its authoritarian political system.
Everybody who's paying attention to science knows that it was Wuhan, China, where this began. And so we blame America and capitalism for what the Chinese did, then we applaud China for their draconian lockdowns and the destruction of civil liberties, what left was left in China.
And here's part of the best part is she actually put this lesson plan on the Zinn Education Project.
There
so let's
go
back to Howard Zinn. And this, there are more than 110,000 teachers who follow this. So there's all, it could be coming to your classroom soon. Now, here's what the result was. According to Mills, her students wanted to put Donald Trump, Mike Pence, and all members of the federal government in jail for their handling of the
Well, all members of the federal government are just Republicans?
Says,
so that you're going to put Clyburn, James Clyburn in prison?
Maybe James,
you're gonna put Maxine Waters in prison?
It's time for some real education. Sabo is the nom de plume of the conservative street artist active in Los Angeles and born in 1968. His name derives from sabot, a device most commonly used in a firearm or cannon ammunition. According to a 2015 interview, Sabo had been involved in street art since 1999, though he began to take his activity in the scene more seriously around 2008. Sabo's works have been critical of left-wing politics, the entertainment industry, and the Democratic Party, claiming correctly that leftism is a mental disorder.
Yeah, and Sabo got his start really in earnest with the election of Barack Obama. The recognition that you had an outsider parvenu, right? The things they hated Donald Trump for, being an outsider, they embraced in Obama. Obama was supposed to be this community organizer. He had no political experience except 3 or 4 months in the Senate before he became a presidential candidate. Those things were wonderful for the empty suit Obama, but they weren't okay for Donald Trump. And so that's what triggered this. And I think that Sabo also was reacting to the non-stop 8 years of media schmaltzing all over Obama. Oh my God, look at the crease in his pants. Oh my God, he's so articulate. Exactly the opposite of, imagine Trump only if the media liked him. That same kind of fawning behavior. So as a street artist, he decided he was going to stick it to all of the progressives and all of their BS. Take a look at some of these images from him. It's one of my favorites. There's Joe Biden as Chairman Mao, right? With the mask hanging off his ear. That's really a pretty stark piece of conservative propaganda. It's really kind of beautiful, actually. Nancy Pelosi. I'm not going to quote on what the bottom half of that picture is, but you begin to get a sense of how savage. And now think about it. This is in Los Angeles. It's not in Nebraska. This is not in Oklahoma. This is taking place in that huge, important piece of property right around Hollywood. In Los Angeles, California, you're getting these images just finding themselves up on the side of bulletin boards, in alleys, paper hung, papers plastered all over the sides of buildings. This is a pretty good one. You can't watch your kids 24/7, but we can. And you've got Anthony Weiner, sausage party boy. You've got Zuck, and you've got Chucky Schumer. These are the people who are going to use technology to watch your kids. I mean, you'd almost be better off finding a guy driving a windowless white van to watch your kids than to have Facebook do it. One of my favorite here, there she is, Maxine Waters in Los Angeles, right? Uncivil Democrats, Halloween, right? There she is with her. And Joe Biden, make this shot a little bit, actually on a backboard of a basketball hoop. Make this shot or you ain't black. You vote for me or you ain't black. Sabo does have kind of a rapier-like wit here. He has a really strong ability to show the underside of all of this fawning leftism. Can you imagine if late-night comedians had the wit of Sabo and were willing to go after Democrat sacred cows the way they go after conservatives? Might actually be funny to watch again. And one of my favorites here is there she is in a WWF, rather let's just call it, can't call that a onesie. That's what, about a 10-Z? An 11-Z? What do you think? First female POTUS, number 45, Hillary Rotten Clinton. That's her stage name. And so in a world that's lost its mind, in a city like Los Angeles that's lost all perspective, in a media that can do nothing but be lapdogs for progressive politics, for him to be operating so successfully inside Los Angeles, more power to you, Sabo.
All right, before we go, just a reminder that the best way to keep up with our various shows at Freedom Project is to follow us on Parler. So take 10 seconds of your day today, right now, go follow at Duke Pesta, at Katie, and at Freedom Project. Now, we want to take a moment to show some love to our Patriot Club members because we so very much appreciate all of them. Today, we're going to give a little shout out to Alan from Kent, Washington. Alan! How's it going out there in Washington? Thank you for supporting us. And if you're a fan of the show and you want to get a shout out, please consider a one-time tax-deductible donation to support our Patriot Club, and we're going to send you this awesome, lovely, stupendous tumbler. Visit patriotclub.us to get started. That's patriotclub.us. And we're going to wrap things up today with the fun fact of the day. And this one isn't so fun, but I hope you're standing while you hear it. Because people who sit 6+ hours per day are 40% more likely to die in 15 years than those who sit 3 hours or less per day.
She says this as we're sitting for hours at a time filming this show. And that is our show for Freedom Project. I'm Dr. Duke. She's Katie. Until next time, stay educated, my friends.